Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 2nd May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi and Bengaluru editions of the newspaper. The handwritten notes in the form of PDF and the timestamping of news articles are available in the description below, and the timestamping for the benefit of mobile phone viewers is also given in the comment section. Coming to the first, this editorial article about antimicrobial resistance appears on page number 8 in Chennai, Bengaluru and Delhi editions of the newspaper. The news article is relevant for your preparation in prelims under current events of national and international importance and economic and social development, general science, and in mains in GS paper 2 in issues relating to health, issues relating to poverty, and in GS paper 3 the article could be linked to Indian economy and issues relating to planning. The issue is in news because recently United Nations Interagency Coordination Group on Antimicrobial Resistance has submitted a report to the Secretary General of the United Nations. The report was titled as No Time to Wait, Securing the Future from Drug-Resistant Infections. Now, about this special group on antimicrobial resistance, see, the group was established as a temporary group or an ad hoc group by the Secretary General of United Nations in the year 2016. Now, this was done as an action to the political declaration of the high-level meeting on antimicrobial resistance that was adopted by the 71st session of United Nations General Assembly in 2016. This group is co-chaired by United Nations Deputy Secretary General and the Director General of World Health Organization, and it comprises of representatives of relevant UN agencies, international organizations and experts across different sectors. The objective of this group is to provide practical guidance to ensure sustained effective global action to address antimicrobial resistance, including options to improve coordination considering the Global Action Plan on Antimicrobial Resistance. Now, let's come to antimicrobial resistance. See, bacteria, viruses, fungi and parasites cause certain infections. To cure these infections caused by them, medications are used. It is found that these bacteria, virus, fungi and parasites are giving resistance to the medications by changing the ways that render the given medications ineffective. Now, this is called antimicrobial resistance. In other words, resistance of a microorganism to an antimicrobial drug that was used for treatment of infections caused by the microorganism. Now, this term antimicrobial resistance is a broader term, but when we say antibiotic resistance, it refers to the resistance offered by bacteria to the use of antibiotics used to treat bacterial infections. Now, imagine we have an antibiotic A to cure an infection X caused by a parasite. Now, there is only one antibiotic available to prevent this disease and to cure it. But the parasite is offering resistance, making the medication of no use at all. In this, if no alternative medication is developed, then people will die. There will be a huge burden because of this in the world, which will have severe impact all over the world. The effects and impacts may continue for decades, unlike the global financial crisis whose effects started to fade within 3 years. The author's statement is that antimicrobial resistance has a huge economic impact, which was not considered by many despite the recognition of antimicrobial resistance as a major health crisis. The author is inspired by the report because it highlights the economic impact of antimicrobial resistance. These impacts the author denotes as costs, and hence the title Costs of Resistance. To be clear, the costs of antimicrobial resistance. Coming to the impacts of the antimicrobial resistance stated by the report and as highlighted by the author in the article, see, if antimicrobial resistance goes uncontrolled, then roughly by 30 years, that is by 2050, it will cause global economic shocks on the levels of 2008-09 financial crisis. And nearly 1 crore human beings are estimated to die every year from 2050 due to drug-resistant infections. Now, around 7 lakh people die globally every year as a result of these infections. Note that of these 7 lakhs, 33% deaths are due to multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Another impacts are, see, the income inequality will widen and there will be increased healthcare expenditures and even the cost of food production will also spike or increase. As a result, the world will lose around 3.8% of the annual GDP by 2050. And one important note is that even by 2030, these drug-resistant infections will push 2.4 crore people to extreme poverty. Now, coming to the efforts taken by Government of India in this regard, see, Government of India constituted a National Task Force on Antimicrobial Resistance Containment in 2010, which led to the development of National Policy on Antimicrobial Resistance Containment in early 2011. Now, this initiative was referred by the author as a plan published 9 years ago. The Ministry of Health and Family Welfare launched a National Program on Containment of Antimicrobial Resistance under the 12th Five-Year Plan, that is during the period 2012 to 2017. And recently, government has published National Action Plan on Antimicrobial Resistance, which is to cover the period 2017 to 2021. And note that the National Center for Disease Control in New Delhi is the focal point for implementation and coordination of antimicrobial resistance program. Now we shall see some steps or suggestions that can be initiated. See, the author states that human use antibiotics has to be phased out in the animal husbandry sector, as scientific evidence demonstrate overuse of antibiotics in animals can contribute to the emergence of antibiotic resistance. For example, to phase out the use of quinolones, which are used to treat bacterial infections in humans and animals, and in order to carry out this suggestion and to enforce it, proper regulation is necessary in enforcing this particular suggestion. And a multi-stakeholder approach involving private pharmaceutical industries, philanthropic groups and citizen activists is needed, where private pharmaceutical industries are asked to distribute drugs in a responsible manner. Philanthropic charities shall fund the development of new antibiotics, and citizen activists should promote and carry out awareness related to AMR or antimicrobial resistance. Also, the stakeholders should emphasize on improved hygiene and vaccination, as these are the only way to postpone antimicrobial resistance, notes the author. Now, these steps are very important for India, and yes, it's a huge task amidst the low immunization rates and drinking water contamination and associated infections. The displayed mains question will be discussed in the final session, the practice cum revision session. Now, let us move on to analyze the next article of the day. This news article on Chandrayaan 2 has appeared on page 6 in Chennai and Bangalore edition and page 5 in Delhi editions. And know that Chandra means moon and Yaan means vehicle. So Chandrayaan, a vehicle to moon. The contents of this news article and our analysis will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance and under general science. And in your mains preparation in GS paper 3 under Achievement of Indians in Science and Technology, Indigenization of Technology and Developing New Technology, and also under Awareness in the Field of Space. This news article has discussed about the Chandrayaan 2 mission and also about the delay in the launch of Chandrayaan 2. The article states that India's second lunar mission, Chandrayaan 2, is set to be launched in July this year by ISRO. It was initially planned during the start of 2019 itself. The mission is planned launched between July 6 to 16 this year. The mission would likely land close to the south pole of the moon by 6th of September this year. The lunar south pole is believed to contain ice and other minerals, and international space expedition plans are actually increasing. If you see, NASA is planning to land astronauts there by 2024. And China also has plans to build a scientific research station on the lunar south pole within the next decade. The main objective of Chandrayaan 2 mission is to orbit the moon and carry out the remote sensing of the moon. Chandrayaan 2 will demonstrate the ability to soft land on the lunar surface or the moon surface and operate a robotic rover on the surface. The payload of this mission will collect various information such as lunar topography, the study of lunar surface, then mineralogy, elemental abundance, and then about lunar exosphere, which is the uppermost region of lunar atmosphere, and finally to detect the presence of hydroxyl and water ice. Let us see about Chandrayaan 2 mission in detail now. The speciality of Chandrayaan 2 mission is that it is a fully indigenous mission, meaning that the entire project is designed within India. There are three modules present. They are orbiter, lander and rover. The orbiter and lander is an integrated module, which means they are launched together into moon's orbit. The lander here is named as Vikram. See, after reaching moon's orbit, the lander housing the rover will separate from the orbiter. After a controlled fall or a controlled descent, the lander will soft land on the lunar surface at a specified site and deploy a rover. The rover is named as Pragyan. Now Chandrayaan 2 is launched using a geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle. That is, Chandrayaan 2 will be launched using a geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle. That is GSLV Mark 3, right? It is a three-stage heavy lift launch vehicle. The launch vehicle is designed to carry 4-ton class heavy satellites to the GTO, that is geosynchronous transfer orbit. Now coming to the rover Pragyan, it is a six-wheeled rover that will move around the landing site in semi-autonomous mode as decided by the ground command. The instruments on the rover will observe the lunar surface or the moon surface and send back data which will be helpful for analysis of the lunar soil. Now the different payloads of Chandrayaan 2. Now the speciality is that all the payloads have been indigenously designed in various institutes of India. The payloads are carried in order to conduct scientific research in the moon. Five payloads have been planned to be attached to the orbiter. Payloads are nothing but the modules to carry out the assigned specific research activities. Firstly, we have large area soft X-ray spectrometer, in short termed as CLASS. This payload will map the major elements placed on the lunar surface. Next is LNS band synthetic aperture radar, which will probe the top surface of the moon. Thirdly, neutral mass spectrometer, which will carry out lunar exosphere studies. Next is imaging IR spectrometer, which will be used to map the lunar surface. Final payload is the terrain mapping camera, which will map the lunar topography. Now there are two payloads that have been planned to be attached to the rover. Both these payloads would carry out the elemental analysis of the lunar surface. Now let us see some significant differences between Chandrayaan 1 and Chandrayaan 2 mission. Chandrayaan 1 was launched in 2008. Chandrayaan 2 is planned to be launched this year, which is 2019. See, Chandrayaan 1 discovered the presence of water molecules in the lunar soil in the south pole of the moon. Chandrayaan 2 intends to carry out further deeper exploration in the same lunar south pole. The major mission of Chandrayaan 1 was remote sensing the moon and planetary science related research of moon. Both these will be carried out by Chandrayaan 2 as well. The significance of Chandrayaan 2 mission will be the rover, which will carry out the on-site chemical analysis on the lunar surface. The payloads of Chandrayaan 1 mission were both indigenous and sourced from abroad. Some major Indian payloads used are hyperspectral imager, high energy X-ray spectrometer. Some major payloads that were sourced from abroad include moon mineralogy mapper and miniature synthetic aperture radar, in short called as mini SAR. The speciality of Chandrayaan 2 mission, as already told, is completely indigenous. So all the payloads of this mission have been developed in India, our own country. Some of the major payloads include the ones that are used in rover. They are laser induced breakdown spectroscope and alpha particle induced X-ray spectroscope. The launch vehicle used for Chandrayaan 1 was Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle C-11, in short called as PSLV C-11,
virus for to launch Chandrayaan 2, GSLV Mark 3 will be used. Thus, for your prelims preparation, try to know the objectives of Chandrayaan 2 mission, major payloads, the launch vehicle used for the mission, and also general comparison with Chandrayaan 1 mission. Have a look at the prelims question. We shall discuss it at the last part of our video.
This article is about listing of Masood Azhar as a global terrorist by 1267 Committee of United Nations Security Council. This appears on page number 1 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Delhi edition. The information given in the article will be relevant in your preliminary examination under the topic Current Events of National and International Importance. And in mains exam, it will be relevant in GS Paper 3 under the role of external state and non-state actors in creating challenges to internal security. The article states that Masood Azhar, the chief of terrorist outfit Jaish-e-Mohammed, has been listed as global terrorist by 1267 Committee of UN Security Council, and India considered this step as a victory for the country for its 10-year-long diplomatic battle on listing Azhar as a global terrorist, and the victory for its long fighting against terrorism in its homeland and also global war against terrorism. As said earlier, India's fight to list Masood Azhar in the global list of terrorists began in 2009, and that is why India called it a decade-old battle. The first proposal by India against Azhar in the UN Security Council was given in 2009. And then in 2016, India had a similar proposal along with P3 countries, which means, you know, P for permanent members of UN Security Council. And these three countries are United States, UK and France. And following this, again in 2017, same countries, you know, US, UK and France had a similar proposal along with India. But these three proposals were blocked by China in the 1267 committee. And this blocked the process of listing Masood Azhar as global terrorist to take effect. And then following the Pulwama terrorist attack in February 2019, where more than 40 Indian soldiers were killed in Jammu and Kashmir, and Masood Azhar headed Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorist organization claimed responsibility for this Pulwama terrorist attack. In this backdrop, France, along with US and UK, initiated the proposal again in 1267 Committee of UNSC to list Azhar as a global terrorist, and this proposal once again blocked by China by putting a hold. To counter China's step, United States circulated a draft resolution in UN Security Council, but outside the ambit of 1267 Committee. The US has asked China either to accept the proposal to list Masood Azhar or to take a stand in taking open proceedings for vote in the 15-member United Nations Security Council. It is understood in diplomatic circles that this acted as a pressure to China, as it thought if voting happened in United Nations Security Council, there might be overriding majority against China, which mean that China is supporting terror. And now, because of pressures, China has altered its decade-long position on listing Masood Azhar as a global terrorist. Now, the impacts on Masood Azhar following this listing. Now, the listing will have effects or impacts such as travel ban, assets freeze, and ban on arms trade for Masood Azhar, which will in turn affect and restrict his organization in terrorist activities such as terror funding, arms acquisition, carrying out attacks, etc. Now, the impacts following the listing of Masood Azhar as global terrorist, you know, first, Masood Azhar or his Jaish-e-Mohammed organization may face international prosecution for their previous terror attacks in India, for instance, terror attacks in Pathankot and Pulwama. Secondly, the resolution, you know, the listing of Masood Azhar will create deterrence or fear to the other terrorist outfits operating in Pakistan soil and in other countries. Thirdly, Pakistan will witness the international pressure will force Pakistan to take legal actions against Masood Azhar and other terrorist outfits which operates from Pakistani soil. And finally, following this listing, it's a great victory for India in fighting terrorism in homeland and also at global level. This may mean decline to the number of terror attacks and terror threats and infiltration of terrorists from Pakistan
and disruption of border areas may considerably reduce in the near future. Now let us focus on UN Security Council, that is UN Security Council Committee, that is 1267 Committee, which is instrumental in listing Masood Azhar as global terrorist. This committee was established following the UN Resolution 1267. This resolution was passed in 1999. And in pursuant to this resolution, this committee, 1267 committee, was established. The committee comprises of all 15 members of UN Security Council. The committee, based on UN Security Council resolution, initially aimed to take actions against the Taliban. Then in 2011, the committee has been renamed or known as Al-Qaeda Sanctions Committee to oversee actions against Al-Qaeda organization and the individuals associated with it. And in 2015, the UN Security Council passed a separate resolution in extending the committee's activities against ISIL terrorist organization. Important function of this committee is to impose a ban on travel and arms trade and also assets freeze of all associated individuals and entities who are listed by the ISIL and Al-Qaeda sanctions list. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the end. Now let's take up next article for analysis. Now the next article is about conservation of World Heritage Glaciers. Now this article appears on page 18 of Chennai. The information under this article is relevant in preliminary examination under current events of international importance, physical geography, general issues on environmental ecology, biodiversity and climate change. In main syllabus in GS paper 1, under the areas salient features of world's physical geography and in important geophysical phenomena and location changes in critical geographical features including water bodies and ice caps and the effects of such changes. And also in GS paper 3 under conservation, environmental pollution and degradation, environmental impact assessment. Disappearing World Heritage Glaciers as a keystone of nature conservation in a changing climate is a study published by American Geophysical Union's in its journal Earth's Future. Now this study was co-authored by IUCN, that is International Union for Conservation of Nature. The study combines data from a global glacier inventory, a review of existing literature and sophisticated computer modeling to analyze the current state of World Heritage Glaciers, their recent evolution, and their projected mass change over 21st century. Today, 247 natural World Heritage Sites are listed for their outstanding universal value in terms of natural beauty or importance for geological and biological diversity and importance for processes and committing states and the international community to make the utmost effort to conserve and transmit them to future generations. So first let's know about glacier. See, a glacier is a large perennial accumulation of crystalline ice, snow, rock, sediment and often liquid water that originates on land and moves downslope under the influence of its own weight and gravity. Glaciers are sensitive indicators of changing climate, but they are more than just disappearing passive climatic indicators. They are key components of planetary ecosystems that influence global climate and sea level, as well as water fluxes, human activities, or biodiversity at the regional scale. The conservation of these iconic endangered features could mobilize global scale conservation and could give climate mitigation benefits. The authors of this study predict glacier extinction by 2100. This will happen under a high carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases emission scenario in 21 of the 46 natural World Heritage Sites where glaciers are currently found. Even under a low emission scenario, 8 of the 46 World Heritage Sites will be ice-free by 2100. The study also expects that 33% to 60% of the total ice volume present in 2017 will be lost by 2100 depending on the emission scenario. They also developed the first ever inventory of glaciers on the UNESCO World Heritage List, documenting about 19,000 glaciers present in 46 out of 247 natural World Heritage Sites. Now, this amounts to 9% of all glaciers on Earth, which have their whole or partial area within natural World Heritage Sites. Among outstanding glaciers, one of the fastest glacier and largest iceberg producer, that is Jakobshavn Isbræ in Greenland. Also, the longest glacier outside continental ice sheets of Bering Glacier in Alaska. And the highest glacier is on Mount Everest in Sagarmatha National Park, which is designated as World Heritage. All these three outstanding glaciers, the largest, longest, highest glaciers, are designated as World Heritage. In this map, glaciers located in natural World Heritage Sites are represented in red dots. Gray polygons are glacierized regions and black dots correspond to all other inventoried glaciers. And this study has found that several iconic landscapes in World Heritage Sites will be impacted by rising temperatures. Iconic landscapes such as Los Glaciers National Park in Argentina contains some of the largest glaciers on Earth, and a very large ice loss of about 60% of the current volume is predicted to happen by 2100 there. In Waterton Glacier International Peace Park, Canadian Rocky Mountain Park, Olympic National Park, which are located in North America, it is predicted that there could be loss of more than 70% of their current glacier ice by 2100, even under drastically lowered CO2 emissions. In Europe, the disappearance of small glaciers is projected in the Pyrenees Mont Perdu World Heritage Site before even 2040. Also, Tewahi Punamu in southwest New Zealand, which contains 3/4 of New Zealand's glaciers, that is almost 75% of New Zealand's glaciers, is projected to lose around 25 to 80% of the current ice volume over the course of this century. And also, according to IUCN World Heritage Outlook 2 report of 2017, climate change is the fastest growing threat to natural World Heritage Sites, with the number of sites threatened by climate change doubling between 2014 and 2017. And the threat of fires ranks second in IUCN World Heritage Outlook 2 report. And in most cases, it is likely that increasing fire risks are linked to climate change impacts. Now, glaciers are among the best climate indicators in nature because their volume depends on air temperature, precipitation, energy exchange at the Earth's surface. Since the 19th century, by limiting snow precipitation and extending and intensifying the melting period of glaciers, the anthropogenic or human impacted global warming has induced a worldwide glacier decline. Also, substantial ice loss since 1990s has affected World Heritage glaciers such as Jakobshavn Isbræ. This glacier has experienced the most severe loss since the 19th century because of the increase of surface and submarine ablation, ice flux and iceberg discharge. Very small glaciers rapidly respond to climatic variations because the climatic variations strongly modify their mass balance and the accumulation area ratio. This accumulation area ratio is nothing but the ratio of the area of the snowfall accumulation zone compared to the entire glacier area. Note that ice volume will rapidly decrease in sites with very small glaciers in a warming climate, while it will take longer time to see a decrease in ice volume in sites with large glaciers. Losing these iconic glaciers would be a tragedy and will have major consequences for the availability of water resources, sea level rise, and weather patterns. This unprecedented decline could also jeopardize the listing of the sites in question on the World Heritage List, as without glaciers they are insignificant. Thus, states must reinforce their commitments to combat climate change and step up efforts to preserve these glaciers for future generations. strong and rapid reduction of greenhouse gas emissions and thereby a deep modification of human impacts on the climate becomes a compelling priority to preserve all glaciers and ice sheets on Earth. World heritage glaciers are thus equivalent to umbrella species. See, umbrella species means the species which had been chosen for conservation, which in turn will protect other species that are under threat, and their conservation will automatically allow and imply the conservation of other features threatened by global warming. Like all glaciers and ice sheets, World Heritage glaciers have also the characteristics of keystone species because of their disproportionately large impacts on nature and societies on Earth. Keystone species are the ones which make a disproportionately large contribution to the ecosystem it inhabits. Now, glaciers and ice sheets have an important influence on global climate and sea level. In many regions, they strongly impact freshwater, sediment and biogeochemical fluxes, biodiversity and geohazards, and protect many nature's contribution to people. Endangered World Heritage glaciers are finally similar to flagship species. Flagship species are used to help raise awareness of the need for conservation by acting as mascots for all sorts of other species in need of our help. And thus it helps in view of the clear international commitment to protect World Heritage sites from damage or loss. To preserve iconic glaciers found in World Heritage sites, we urgently need to see significant cuts in greenhouse gas emissions. This is the only way of avoiding long-lasting and irreversible glacier decline and the related major natural, social, economic, and migratory cascading consequences. This study on glacier decline further emphasizes the need for individual and collective actions to achieve the mitigation and adaptation aspirations of the Paris Agreement on Climate Change. The displayed mains question will be discussed in the last session. Now let's move on to the next article. This news about GST collection has appeared in page 1, and the news about the implications of healthy GST collections has appeared in page 10 in all the editions taken for today's analysis. The statistics given in this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance and under economic development, and in your mains preparation in GS paper 3 under Indian economy. The news article in the front page has discussed about the record GST collection in the month of April 2019. The GST collection amount for April 2019 is 1.13 lakh crore rupees. It has almost seen a 10% growth when compared to April 2018 data. In March 2019, the collections amounted to 1.03 lakh crore rupees. It was 97,247 crore rupees in February 2019. GST collections were high in January 2019 at 1.02 lakh crores. The GST collection for December and November stood at 94,725 crore and 97,637 crore. Thus, one can see the fluctuations in the GST collections when we see these 6 months data. Let us now see the gross GST revenue collection data for the month of April 2019. As we saw above, the total GST collection for the month is 1.13 lakh crore rupees. Generally, the integrated goods and service tax share is higher in this pool. IGST for April 2019 was 54.7 thousand crore rupees out of the total collection of 1.13 lakh crore. The state GST share is around 28.8 thousand crore rupees and the central GST share is 21.1 thousand crore rupees. Now, the share of CESS was 9.1 thousand crore rupees. The second news article related to GST collections notes that the increase in GST collections for April 2019 is encouraging, that the increase in collections denote an increase in the tax base. Let us see the implications of higher GST revenues and the reasons that are leading to higher GST revenues. Higher GST collections imply that the tax base is gradually increasing such that the GST has started getting stabilized in India. The introduction of e-way bill has been successful and it has also led to higher revenues in GST collections. Further, now data mining is possible with the introduction of e-way bill. See, data mining refers to the usage of huge available data for various purposes such as study, research, or even to monitor the processes. GST is an indirect tax. So let us know about the indirect tax to GDP ratio for the last 3 years and the impact of GST introduction on this indirect tax to GDP ratio. In the financial year 2015-16, the indirect tax to GDP ratio stood at 5.16%. It increased to 5.65% in the financial year 2016-17. But in the financial year 2017-18, the indirect tax to GDP ratio reduced to 5.43%. If you see, GST was introduced in this financial year only, that is on July 1, 2017. We can see the impact of GST introduction in the low indirect tax to GDP ratio. The indirect tax to GDP ratio data for the financial year 2018-19 is not available. So with this, we come to the end of the analysis of these two news articles. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last part of the video. Now let us move on to the next news article. This article is a data point titled "The Cost of Military Might" and has appeared in page number 9 in all the relevant editions taken up for analysis. These statistics will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance and in your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 3 under security challenges and their management in border areas. This data point discusses about the military expenditures by key countries of the world. The data discussed here is based on the military expenditure database by Stockholm International Peace Research Institute. The data tells that the worldwide military expenditure has increased to $1.8 trillion in 2018, which has seen a 2.6% growth when compared to 2017. Now, these are the top 5 countries that spend huge amounts for defense. The largest is by United States of America, which accounts for 36% of the total share of military expenditures of all countries. The second largest is China, which accounts for 14% of the total share of military expenditures. Now, both these countries, see, United States and China, account for exactly half of the total military expenditure of the world. Next in the list is Saudi Arabia, which has a 3.7% share. And fourth in this list is India, which also has almost 3.7% of total world's share, slightly lesser than Saudi Arabia. The fifth largest country in this list is France, which accounts for 3.5% of the total world's share. The defense spending for these top 5 countries is also given here in the table. All the values given are in million US dollars for the year 2018. See, USA spent 649 million US dollars, China spent 250 million US dollars, Saudi Arabia 67.6 million US dollars, and India 66.5. Now, both these exact values of Saudi Arabia and India are sourced from military expenditure database. Both these values are roughly mentioned in the newspaper as 67 and 65 million US dollars. Finally, France spent 63.8 million US dollars in 2018. The annual change in spending for the year 2018 when compared to 2017 is given here. If you see, India's military spending has increased by 3.1%, whereas Saudi Arabia's spending has decreased by 6.4%. Note that Saudi Arabia's spending has decreased by 6.4%. This is with reference to the value of spending, not with respect to as a percent of its GDP. Next, you need to know in brief about SIPRI, which is Stockholm International Peace Research Institute. SIPRI is an independent international research institute dedicated to conduct research into conflicts, armaments, arms control, and disarmament globally. So, as a part of this, military expenditure database is being released annually by this institute. SIPRI was established in the year 1966 and it is based at Stockholm, Sweden. Now, from this database, we have taken 2 5-year period data specific to India. First one is the military expenditure data of India as a percentage of its GDP. And the next one is per capita military expenditure data for the previous 5 years. It is given in graph format for an easy understanding to know the past 5 year trend. First, let us see military expenditure data of India as a percentage of its GDP. If you see from the graph, India's military expenditure stands a little less than 2.5% of its GDP. In 2014, it was 2.5% and then it is reduced to 2.4% in 2015, then 2.5% in 2016 and almost the same in 2017 as well. But in 2018, it again reduced to 2.4%. Thus, India's military expenditure stands a little less than 2.5% of its GDP for the past 5 years. Now, let us see about per capita military expenditure data of India for the past 5 years. Per capita military expenditure means the military expenditure for one person present in that country. Higher the population of the country, the per capita military expenditure values will naturally be less. The per capita expenditure value is calculated in US dollars. The per capita military expenditure was $39.4 in 2014. Then it saw a slight reduction to $39.2 in 2015. The value increased to 42.8 in 2016 and then 48.2 in 2017. 2018 also saw an increase in the per capita military expenditure at $49.1. Thus, the average per capita military expenditure is around $43.7 in India. If you see, Saudi Arabia is the country with highest per capita military expenditure, which is over $2,000. It simply means over $2,000 is spent for one person as military expenses in Saudi Arabia. Both these graphs could be useful in your mains answer writing. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. We are now in our final session, practice cum revision session. So let's look into the first question. Consider the following statements. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. The statements are with reference to Chandrayaan 2. First statement. The main objective of Chandrayaan 2 is to demonstrate the ability to soft land on the lunar surface and operate a rover on the surface. The second statement, the major payloads of Chandrayaan 2 mission, that is developed indigenously, include laser-induced breakdown spectroscope and neutral mass spectrometer. Now see, in the second statement, we know that the Chandrayaan 2 mission is completely indigenous. And in our analysis of news article, we saw the first two statements are correct. We have discussed in our analysis. Now the third statement, Chandrayaan 2 will be launched using a 4-stage heavy lift geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle Mark 3. Now this statement is wrong because GSLV is a 3-stage launch vehicle. And of course, although the name is true, you know, GSLV Mark 3, it is not using a 4-stage process. Rather, it is a 3-stage launch vehicle. Therefore, third statement is incorrect. So you have to easily eliminate option C and option D because it has third statement in there. So we have to decide between option A and B. So where we find 1 and 2 are correct. So answer will be option B, 1 and 2 only. Now the second question is with reference to 1267 committee of UNSC, that is United Nations Security Council. Two statements are given. They are asking which of the statements are correct. First statement, it comprises of all the 15 members of Security Council. Yes, it comprises of 5 permanent members and 10 non-permanent members of the Security Council, which is correct. The second statement, it can impose ban on travel, arms embargo and freeze assets of individuals listed as global terrorists by it. The second statement is correct, as we have seen in the analysis. And therefore, the answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Coming to the third question, now this question is with respect to GST collections. And they have given two statements and are asking which statements are correct. First statement, GST collections in India consistently crossed 1 lakh crore rupees in the last 6 months. Now, we saw in our discussion that GST collections have seen continuous fluctuations in the past 6 months, sometimes even recording below 1 lakh crore rupee as well. So, the first statement is wrong. Now, the second statement, IGST or integrated GST is the highest contributor to the total GST tax pool. Now, this statement is correct. So, from the given options, option B, 2 only will be the correct answer for this question. Antimicrobial resistance is an emerging challenge globally and for India. What are the possible impacts in future and suggest measures for tackling the challenge? Now, in brief, you may state what is AMR or antimicrobial resistance in 2 or 3 lines and also about the casualties as a result of AMR now and the expected number of deaths it could cause in the future. For the second part about the possible impacts in future, you may highlight the economic impacts, you know, predicted for the future as given in the today's analysis. And for the third part, you may add the measures discussed by the author and add up your own suggestions for improvement of the current situation or the situation that may come for the future. Question 2. Climate change is a global problem. How natural world heritage sites will be affected by climate change? For answering this question, first list out the problems caused by climate change like threat to biodiversity, loss of lives, extreme weather events, you know, rise of sea level, all happening in several parts of the world. Use such points to briefly highlight that climate change is a global problem. For the second part of the question, list the points discussed in our analysis on how the climate change is impacting the glaciers and how it speeds up the process of their melting. Then substantiate with how to tackle the problem.